Please come to order. Good evening and welcome. I am Randy Guy, President Commissioner of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other Commissioners. Tom Jarvo, who represents the First Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. George Island, will be joining us via teleconference. Is he on now?
Yes.
I'm on.
Okay, Tom, good. He's down in South America. Just let you know where he's at. Sitting to my right, representing the Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown, Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good evening.
Sitting to my left, representing the Third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, Seventh District, Golden Beach, Mr. John O'Connor.
Good evening.
And representing the Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Southern California, and Great Mills, Mr. Todd Morgan. Seated next to Commissioner Morgan at the end of the table is Dr. Rebecca Bridget, our County Administrator. On my immediate right is Bonnie Gray, our recorder for tonight. Ms. Amy Carter is our video media producer. She is behind the glass. So when you come forward, please look good, smile, and speak clearly into the microphone because you're going to be on TV. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. When you come to the for podium in the front here to speak, please approach by coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised, so you need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. This public hearing is for a proposed ordinance on commercial dock use. Sign-in sheets were provided out front. If you have not signed in and wish to speak, we ask that you sign in now. We will now have a presentation from our Director of Land Use and Growth, Mr. Bill Hunt, and also from David Weisskopf, our Acting County Attorney.
Mr. President, based on advice from Mr. Weisskopf, I'll recuse myself.
Okay, you're recused.
Thanks.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening. David?
Good evening.
Mr. Hunt?
As you said, tonight's public hearing is for the purpose of receiving public comment and to consider a proposed ordinance on commercial dock use associated with the on and off loading of seafood catch from new DNR authorized shellfish aquaculture leases. Notice of this public hearing was posted and published in the Enterprise on August 10th, 15th, and 17th. The proposed ordinance would direct county staff to study aquaculture operations and expansion of industrial and commercial seafood processing, finalize their recommendations and propose changes to the St. Mary's County Comprehensive Plan. While this study was taking place, there would be an 18-month moratorium on the use of docks or piers for any commercial activity associated with the on and off loading of seafood catch from new DNR authorized shellfish aquaculture leases. And if DNR revises the rules and regulations, that this moratorium may be shortened. The ordinance would only apply to any new DNR aquaculture lease issued on or after the effective date of this ordinance. And it's also my further understanding that the intent of this ordinance is only to apply to water column leases, and we can easily make that adjustment.
Okay.
So that's really the presentation that the two of us were going to give, and at this time, suggest getting the ball rolling with public testimony.
Less is more.
Okay.
Thank
you all very much. Now, before we get started, I just make a quick statement that this all started from many complaints from citizens who live along the shoreline. They were concerned about their notification process and had such a short notification before it started. So some were very concerned about safety in front of their property by commercial, not just commercial use, but by recreational use, their own use. That seemed like it completely eliminated much of the other uses of this water area. So that's when we started acting on this. I got to admit, I had very minimal amount of, I know about oysters. I grew up in this area myself, but I never heard of water column leasing until I got introduced actually at the Hollywood Oyster. Is Mr. Petty here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We went down to his, and I was very impressed. Of course, most of the columns he has in his water is on his property. So, of course, no one even thought much about it. But I will say that his oysters have expanded nationwide. I was down in Charleston about a year and a half ago, and there was Hollywood Oyster Company Sweet Jesus Oysters on the menu. I mean, I was sort of proud of being a St. Mary's County resident that these were out there. And I'm not against oyster whatsoever. I think it's a great thing. And I suppose the thing of it is that the citizens who owned property was seen to be the ones that were, it was such a restrictive notification of this process in front of them. So that's when we started looking at this. And DNR seemed to be limited as far as what they wanted to do. Their interpretation of the regulation, The ordinance is designed to sort of delay a little bit so that we can deal with DNR. We've had two meetings. They pretty much read us the law. The first meeting was the 1st of August. The law stated what they can and cannot do, but of course, they have variations on how they interpret the law. We were questioning the interpretation of the law by DNR, and that was the big thing we had. But we understand the law is what it is, and they regulate all the uses of the waters within the state of Maryland, Chesapeake Bay and its tributaries, and I understand that. We all understand that. We're asking them to look closely to make sure they give notification earlier to everyone as they're going through this process. Most of the people that we talked to as far as landowners were not notified until almost the last 30 days prior to giving the lease. And then all of a sudden, if they objected to it, then it went into another delay. So actually, at times, it was delaying the process, sometimes a year or more, or a couple of years, before the actual lease got finally processed. So it's we need to get communications a little bit better here amongst DNR, the watermen, and the people who own property along the shoreline. So it's just, and that's what started all of this. The ordinance for new water column leases only. It does not apply to anyone else. I don't care if you're eel potting, crabbing, anything else, regular oystering, it does not restrict any of you. This is for water column leasing only, is the way this ordinance looks at right now. So if DNR revises or does a better job of interpreting the regulation, that I would say this probably may never even happen. Or if it does, we would rescind it sooner if they change the way they're doing business. And right now, we've been on two focus groups already. We've got another one meeting next week, and then probably 2 weeks from then. And we're still working on the procedure. So with that said, I'm going to let you, the public, speak. But believe me, this will hit the streets. And DNR is probably watching this right now. And we're hoping the information we get tonight, we want to know how you feel about this, how it impacts you, and where we're going with it. Commissioners, you got any other questions? All right. Nothing. Okay. We will now have the presentation is over with now. We will now open the hearing for public comments. We ask that you keep remarks to 3 minutes, or if you are representing a group, you will have 5 minutes. And I will start the process now.
Just do me a favor. If you have that tripod, you can't block the doorway at all. It's an emergency exit. You can go in the corner, or if you want to set up over here, out of the way, this way, as long as it's not blocking the doorway. I appreciate it.
Okay. First speaker is it Thomas Chasen? Thomas Chasen? And when you come forward, make sure you give your name and address. Speak clearly into the microphone, please.
Hi, my name is Tom Chason. I live on 49470 Curley's Road, Ridge, Maryland. I'd just like to say that I'm against the oysters going in the first place. So the fact that they want to use our public docks to on and offload their products is just seems wrong to me that those piers and docks were put there for public use and should be kept clear for public people to launch their boats and whatnot. I'd also like to say that the navigation caused by these oyster pots and the floats attached to them is detrimental to the use of the public waterways. I know that's off topic, but that's a big concern of mine, that I won't be able to get my boat in and out of the oyster pot area. And lastly, I'd like to speak for the wildlife in the area. The area in which they're putting those oyster pots is used by skates to raise their young, and I'd like to say that I'd like to see the skates continue to be able to use that area and not be swarming in and amongst those oyster pots. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next, we have Mr. Phil Dorsey.
Thank you. President, I represent a group from St. Mary's County. I ask for 5 minutes. County Commissioners, my name is Phil Dorsey. I'm from Leonardtown. I'm here to support this ordinance and this moratorium for 18 months. This hearing is not about all the good work that the state and individuals in this room have been doing to expand oyster aquaculture over the last 10 years. This is not about the science of water quality or how the great bivalvular, inequivalvular mollusk is for our bay and the tributaries. This is about listening to local governments and what they want to balance the growth of this industry in the future. The reason there is a hearing tonight is simple. There needs to be a working group representing all interests on the local level to forge some compromise, discussion, and some concrete enforcement measures to deal with water column leases. This hearing has emerged as a result of several years of nonstop Wild West growth of the water column lease surge in St. Mary's County. The only way to placate both sides of the debate should be a substantive set of homegrown ideas to foster growth of the industry, to require accelerated use or lose provisions in the lease area so that it is not monopolized by a few, and concrete provisions and amendments to the Natural Resources Article 411.08, only through the legislative process. Without codifying the state natural resources article, it leaves little mechanism to control this on the local level, if at all. Oysters, as we know it, are the purest filter mechanisms we can unleash on the enhancement of our water quality and proven to be the best tool over many generations. The state has said we're going to back anyone who wants to put in a water column lease, even as far as lending them Attorney General support working with their lawyers in the various appellate processes. And the county is left with no say in the matter. And the problems are many. De minimis notice provisions to the landowner, cages with no yield formula per acre, acres that isn't worked and tied up for close to 20 years, navigable impediments to shallow water navigation, trout line, swimming, kayakers, paddleboarders, jet skis, skiffs. I don't know of hardly anyone that has a problem with oyster sanctuaries, bottom leases, Yates bars. But Carl Roescher and his able staff have put forward a permitting machine that has done a great job of promoting these water column leases. But he's done a real bad job of listening to local counties, jurisdictions, needs, which therefore take advantage of the public's inability to fight it on a local level. So if you're listening to that, and you people in Annapolis are listening, you can do better, and I hope you will do better. St. Mary's County has the second largest amount of lease bottom behind Dorchester County in total acreage, but we have the largest amount of water column leases in the state. And the practical effects are as follows. You shut down 235 for a mile. What are the effects? You're doing the same thing out in the shallows all around this county, creating impediments. Nobody owns the water, but basically that's what it's occurring. The bottom line is they're putting their cages where they shouldn't. And when you put cages in the shallows, that prevents the use of recreational use, and that's a serious problem. 20 years on the leases is a long time. There needs to be safeguards. You should have a right to veto as the property owner. You need to set up separate zones. How many cages per acre is allocated? You need to have proper siting charts. I've heard of one instance where there's supposed to be 6,000 cages. I hope you pass this and work towards a much needed solution.
Thank you, Mr. Dorsey.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have Mr. James Raley. representing St. Mary's County Farm Bureau.
Thank you, Commissioner Guy. Jamie Raley, 26737 radio station way in Leonardtown, President of County Farm Bureau. As you mentioned earlier at the onset of the meeting, you didn't have a whole lot of knowledge of this, and neither did we, so we brought in some subject matter experts after we obtained a photocopy of the letter that the citizens submitted to the Board of Commissioners requesting some relief in this matter. We had lobbyists from Maryland Farm Bureau, the chairperson of the Maryland Oyster Aquaculture Commission. We brought in a fishery scientist from Chesapeake Bay Foundation, and we had the chairman of the Southern Maryland Shellfish Growers Association come in and talk to our board of directors. With their guidance and through the investigation, we found that Maryland Farm Bureau recognizes aquaculture as a branch of agriculture. The St. Mary's County Right to Farm Ordinance mentions aquaculture in a couple places, one in the definition of agriculture and also in what is an agricultural operation. Aquaculture is listed in there. Again, at the local level, we found that the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy that the board accepted in 2017 lists aquaculture here in the county as a targeted industry cluster with a recommendation that it be promoted by our county's Economic Development Commission. And then lastly, with the help of the Chesapeake Bay Foundation scientists, it told us what we already know on that particular aspect about oyster filtration and the fact that it might be advantageous for agriculture during the next round of the water improvement process. The WIP 3 program is getting ready to start. So with all this information together, we looked at your proposed ordinance that you had out. In one place, it refers to commercial marine docks, but then when you read down into the wording, it just says docks and piers. So that could be commercial marine zoning or RPD zoning, but whatever it is, Farm Bureau respectfully requests that you not endorse, not approve the ordinance, and you know, we're opposed to it for the time being. We recommend that perhaps the Board of Commissioners take the information from this meeting this evening and the dialogue that you have with the citizens, and maybe we could work with our elected officials in the legislative delegation to see if we can give some relief to the folks that are affected by this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Reilly. Next, we have Helen Daugherty.
I'm Helen Daugherty, and I live at 46619 Millstone Landing Road in Lexington Park. Right now, we have a sinking ship in front of our house.
Yes. We've seen pictures of it.
Yeah. That's our house. I want to first emphasize that we are supporting the moratorium. It's an 18-month moratorium so that the citizens of St. Mary's County can have a dialogue on how we want to participate in the state's initiative of aquaculture gardening to improve the Chesapeake Bay. Just as land use issues are discussed at the county level, so too should we have the opportunity to discuss the health, safety, and welfare issues associated with for-profit agriculture oyster farming in St. Mary's County. Now, tonight I come with questions because what we're supporting is a moratorium so that people can talk to each other. So I'm here to ask questions that I think the citizens of St. Mary's must address. Most of them have to do with safety. Starting, however, with the idea is, what is the formula for deciding the acreage that can be cultivated and how are the sites allocated? I have looked all over the Department of Natural Resource website and I can't find the answers to the questions I'm asking today. They might be there, but I can't find them. How do we assess safety? Whose safety? Who determines that, as one application wrote, there's not much boat traffic? I don't know how that was determined, so that the lease will not interfere with current activity. What is the measurements that we're using to make those decisions that rest on safety? If the cages break away, who holds the liability if somebody gets hurt? boaters, kayakers, swimmers, jet skiers, all sorts of people who are using that water are risking themselves if they're out there competing with a broken cage. Another question I have is, what do we do if the cages are untended? Now, 1 year we had a pound net, and I believe the person that had it became very ill and so couldn't attend it. And we had dead fish up on the beach. We had all sorts of other things. And there was no process to look and say, can you continue with this lease that you have? And I think, as Phil Dorsey said, these are 20-year leases. And so what is there a process at all? Can you lose the lease, and under what conditions? So given the number of marinas, private piers, community docking sites, et cetera, we have a great number of people and boats all subject to harm if even one of those cages breaks away. On the health issue, I'm worried about if you unload your oysters at one marina and must transport them to another area, how do we ensure quality control? Oysters are fragile. What type of refrigeration is needed? Should there be some kind of health department certification? Thank you. I know I've used my time, and I want to thank you for your concern. Again, it was said that St. Mary's is taking a hit as one of the largest groups of place where we have these things, and so I think we really need to ask these questions. Thank
you. Yes, ma'am. Thank you very much. Next, I think we have John Dean. Mr. Dean, how you doing, sir?
My name's John Dean, 49925 Hayes Beach Road, Scotland, Maryland. I'm also the chairman of St. Mary's County Watermen Association. And the watermen that I have spoken to are very much opposed to this. Even though it is for new leases, who's going to determine what's what? When we come in with oysters, are they going to be wild, or are they going to be aquaculture? We are very much opposed to it. And we're also have been on the record, we're opposed to the water column leases. But this has been forced upon us, all of us in this room, from up above. Nobody had any say in any of this when it first happened. And St. Mary's County and Calvert County, Tommy's Inns Association, we teamed up and we have fought these leases. And we that was our trial case, and we lost. And we can't win, and it's just the way it is. And the other thing is, we need to get it right, because a lot of people are unaware the Potomac River Fisheries is getting ready to start leasing the Potomac. It's going to be a couple years down the road, but they're in the process. So we need to be getting this stuff right. And that's pretty much all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dean. I think it's Dan, is it Rabarchik? That sound right? Dan, okay, yes. I'm sorry. I wasn't sure I could read it very well. Dan, I'm sorry about that.
Sorry.
Yeah, I don't write real neat.
Good evening, Dan Rabarchik, 45100 Nolan Court, Hollywood, Maryland, and I have a waterfront home. I'm here to speak that I am against what you want to do. Nobody can seem to tell me, as it was said by Mr. Raley, what the pier is, commercial, residential. You're going to tell me that I can't do something at my personal pier that I pay $8,000 a year taxes on? It kind of upset me. Oyster farming right now is the next modern waterman. Our watermen have struggled for years. This is a new industry. Some of them are grabbing it and taking it. Some of them are not ready to yet. But I think St. Mary's County needs to embrace the future of what this country is looking for. I do know that local oyster companies are shipping to
the Carolinas. They're shipping to Florida. We're going. Our name's in Denver. It's in California. These companies are doing their best to create an industry. That industry hires people. That industry puts money back in St. Mary's County, just the same as any other business does. I feel that some people may not like to see them out in front of their house, more so than the hazard they've caused. The ones that I've seen are not that close to the shoreline. Yes, they do take up quite a bit of space. The crabbers seem to love them because crabs seem to flock towards where the oysters are, you know, churning up the water. So there's a lot of pluses. The other negative I see is when you talk about the oysters, look at the crab pots that are out there. You want to talk about navigation? I have more problem navigating through crab pots than I do a set oyster area where I can see the floats. They're in a square or a rectangle, okay? But when I see crab pots going boom, 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 I know the man's making a living, but you're trying to compare the oyster leases to other things out there that are hazardous. Next thing you know, we're going to stop all the watermen's livelihood. We're not going to be able to have pound nets. We're not going to be able to have crab pots because somebody's going to say, I don't like that barge sitting out there because that guy's doing something to crab pots or he's doing something else. I mean, you put a barge in front of your house, you don't like the way it looks. If the county wants to make an adjustment in your property taxes, so be it. I don't think anybody's going to sell their waterfront house for 25% less on the market just because there's oysters out front. So in my opinion, I think what you're trying to do, you need to give it a lot of thought because there are people who make a living doing this, and it seems that nobody in the county government can tell me what a commercial pier is, and these watermen pay taxes too, which means they paid for the part of that pier, and if they want to use it, they should be allowed. I don't know any waterman that doesn't take care of his stuff, clean up after himself, that kind of thing. They have respect for their livelihood. And that's all I got to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Mr. Meatyard?
Hello, my name is Spike Meatyard. I'm coming from Tall Timbers. Just want to thank you for...
Is it 18521 Herring Creek Road?
18521 Herring Creek Road.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Just want to thank you for holding this hearing regarding oyster aquaculture and bringing this diverse group of county citizens and business owners here today. My name is Frederick Meatyard. Most people know me as Spike. I'm a fifth generation county citizen and small business owner, oyster farmer, and waterfront homeowner. This moratorium will greatly stunt the future growth of my company, and my goal is to improve the health of my childhood creek, river, and bay, as I am an oyster farmer that grows oysters in cages. I think it is safe to say every oyster farmer in this room is striving to improve the county ecologically, culturally, and economically. Improving the above shall only enhance and promote health, safety, welfare, and affluence for our county citizens. I understand oyster cages, floats, or buoys to mark their presence changes the view of our traditional bay landscape. But I can assure you it is no different than a crab pot, buoy, pound net, gill net, a Harris Teeter on 235, or a new waterfront home. I hope that you, our county commissioners, do the right thing and embrace this change in infrastructure in our bay to encourage a new method of oyster harvesting to improve our county culture, ecology, and economy. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Rita Weaver.
Good evening. I'm Rita Weaver, 49588 Wills Road, Dameron. My husband and I are owners of over 2,000 feet of waterfront property. This acreage is the most beautiful area in St. Mary's County and in Maryland. Not only are we taxed for the view, but also taxed for our pier and boathouse. We are required to buy a license for a boat and another license to fish. This is a tax. Another fee is a riparian rights or license to our shoreline. I'm required to purchase a license to hunt from my property This in turn prevents others from hunting in this area. Yes, this is just another tax. We have had land loss due to tides and wake from boats. To keep from losing more shoreline, we will need to place riprap in these areas. How will a barge carrying rocks navigate through a sea of oyster flats to get to our land in order to place riprap to shore up our property? We've had numerous restrictions placed on us and on our land due to critical area in the Chesapeake Bay. This is all part of living on the water. But yet, the agriculture and in the name of agriculture, legislators find it necessary to potentially lease the waterways around my land. This is double dipping. First, I am heavily taxed for living on the water, and then the person purchasing the water rights to place their oyster flats or cages is charged a fee. If this happens, we will not be able to use our boat for recreational purposes or to go fishing. How will I retrieve the waterfowl while hunting? And how will a barge reach our shoreline to place rocks so we don't continue to lose land if these oyster flats are 50 feet off our property line? 50 feet is not that far. Potentially, our waterfront property could become less desirable to own or purchase and lead to a decrease in property value. Like I said, just like others have said coming up before me, there's no clear regulations provided. Since District 1 was just assessed for property value, will you be sending someone to reassess our property and lower taxes due to this legislation? Yes, I know that our property ends at mean high tide, but then if this is the case, I would expect that the county and state tax me in this manner, that my property ends at mean high tide, and that I would be taxed just like any other landowner in St. Mary's County that does not have or own waterfront property. Thank you for having this meeting, listening, and taking into consideration my concerns.
Thank you, Ms. Weaver. Richard Pels.
My name is Richard Pels. 49676 Freeman's Road, Dameron, Maryland. I'm probably the cause of this meeting because I've been growing oysters in floats and water column for 30 years now in St. Mary's County in different places. And I wanted to let you know that there's been a lot of disinformation given to you on the negative side because I've been through the mill on this, and I understand the concerns. And a lot of them are already taken care of in regulation and law. One of the things that was brought up was there needs to be a use it or lose it. There's a use it or lose it clause in every single one of the leases. I have a current lease. I have three in process on St. Jerome's Creek. Every single one of those, the one I currently have and the three that I have pending, there have been zero complaints from any of the neighbors. I've notified them well in advance. It's one of the first things that has to be done in order to even file the paperwork. And if you put this in with that use it or lose it clause, I automatically am in violation of that lease if I get it, and because I would not be allowed to plant that lease from my own dock that I own on St. Jerome's Creek. And it's because it's a commercial operation there. And I've been one of the things that I think is really important that you know is that if you look at the growth of oyster leases in St. Mary's County, water column lease has been was corrected today, and it's only been like averaging 3 acres per year for water column. All the rest of the leases are on the bottom. And if you look at St. Jerome's Creek, for example, there's 2.4 square miles there. That's 1,500 acres. How many years would that take at 25 acres or even at 3 acres of water column lease to bring it up to capacity? 25 years, 30 years. Slowing the thing down. That's another issue. It's already slow. My first aquaculture lease took me 8 years to get. My second one took me 5 years to get. I'm in 3 and 4 years on the ones that I've got in process. And it's there's all of the concerns about safety and other uses are already addressed in the lease process. They have to look at 28 different things. And if you if any of those are in violation, you don't get the lease, but you have to forfeit the permit application anyway. So you look at it from that side of it. And the other thing is that one of the pieces of misinformation here is that you don't have a right to say nobody in front of your property. Okay, just one last point. If you're on a riparian rights creek, like St. Jerome's Creek is, nobody can put a lease in front of your property at all. And that needs to be said. They will not be issued without your permission.
Thank you, sir. Hey, Mr. Bob Parkinson.
Commissioner Jarvis online.
We got you, Tom.
Hi, I'm Bob Parkinson, Moonstruck Oysters, 43765 Little Cliffs Road, Hollywood, Maryland. Same creek as Commissioner Hewitt. Thank you for giving me a bite of your time to express my concern with the consequences of your proposed moratorium. Facts and their derivatives from the details of the Bay Journal article, which is the best detail I had, since the start of use or lose of leases in 2010, 97 leases have been issued to in St. Mary's counties for an average of 16.3 acres per lease. That sounds like a lot. Many of those leases are from previous decades where they were allowed to be fallow and not used. Now they are. Also stated was 4 out of 5 were bottom leases. That means 24 of those leases were water column. Converting that to water column acres per year since 2010, that's 3 acres per year. That's not rampant growth. Using a letter from 13 waterfront homeowners who object to restriction on field of view as a concern couched in water restrictions recreational areas as a counter, I suggest that the 24 folks who have water column leases are more than 13, almost twice as much. We were not asked. I would love to have a picture of 38 North. If you saw there, if you read there and looked at that article, those floats in front of my place, I have a nursery in my place because I can't do anything more. I've been restricted by the state. Knowing the economic value and the environmental value of having those floats on the creek. My third concern is not Bay Journal article, but deals with language of the moratorium. Use of all docks. That includes mine. Somebody else also mentioned earlier. To me, that includes my dock in St. Thomas Creek. I now have a lease to operate an oyster nursery from that dock. You are suggesting that in the future, should I get a lease out in the Ducks River, I cannot use that dock for the purpose of what it could be used for. If you've ever looked at where the leases in the Patuxent River could be, they're pretty dramatic. We have a problem with the watermen, but that's okay. That's the clamming operation, but that's not waterfront property. I'd like to provide more. I am in the business today of to give back to our community. You all know that I had a very successful career in the Navy and as a contractor in their support. In the oyster business, I got my roots in Circle C, Rich Bells you just heard from, some experience with True Chesapeake, and had the opportunity to help kickstart Hollywood Oysters. Not sure about them, but Moonstruck Oysters sees a future in helping those who are in desperate need of work for a fair price. I can do that, but do not need this additional red herring of government obstruction. To me, your suggested moratorium is counterproductive economically for our county. It is also anti-environmental. In fact, the cages and floats provide protective habitat for fingerling, fish, crab, eel protection as they grow. Maybe you should press your staff and government committees to get an education program going that, as to the need for oyster aquaculture in our great county. My request is that you withdraw this suggested moratorium. With that, thank you for your time.
Thank you, Bob, and you do grow some pretty nice spat. My brother's enjoyed it very much the last couple years. We have been enjoying his oysters with floating around his dock. We thank you for that. Next, Tucker Brown.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I would like to defer. I would like to speak last.
All right, sir. Thank you very much. Next, Mr. Deal. Dean, I think it's Tim Dean. Is that right? Tim Dean? Mr.
Tim
Dean, how you doing?
I live at 49653 Buzz's Marina Way in Bridge, Maryland. I own Saturday's Choice Seafood, and I'm a small oyster seafood processor. I'm opposed to the ordinance, commissioners, and here's why. Something needs to be done about water quality. If we keep fighting over catch limits and fishery rules without attacking the real problems, we'll get nothing accomplished. Watermen are not destroying water quality. It's the water quality that we need in order to make our living, and the culprits are industries other than commercial watermen that are killing our livelihood. Real estate ventures, construction, bad planning, weak enforcement. Reading the recent article in the Bay Journal that talks about waterfront property owners and others, well, I'm talking about the others. How come watermen are being more vigorously regulated than other industries? Increasingly scarce fisheries are a symptom of a much larger problem that nobody wants to talk about. Since 2006 and lately, every time I apply for a permit, the neighboring marina is opposed to it, claiming they're being treated unfairly for whatever reason if it's granted. What people don't know about this are lots of other root causes and problems for watermen, plus the many real estate development schemes that are flooding pollutants in our waterways. So you're right. Waterfront property values are going to go down. Your views are going to be terrible, not to mention the smell. The tourist trade will be devastated, not to mention our natural resource will suffer drastically. It already is. Daily, I dump crab traps that are sometimes full of dead crabs because of the red tide. Have you ever really seen the effects of this that originates from sewage toxins leaching into the water? Well, I have. And I'm against anyone who knowingly allows this and causes this to happen. That's why I'm against Henderson and anyone like him who stretches the intent of the law and doesn't always play by the rules.
Excuse me, Mr. Dean. This is not a court of law.
I agree.
You're not bringing any names up, sir.
Okay.
You're talking
I'll
about
go on and I'll try to keep the names
about.
Out.
All
it's
right?
Clear to me that stakeholders like him are behind the public outcry and angry letters sent to you. They are rallying support groups that really have no clue what's actually going on, and especially given the information gathered at the May 24, 2000 meeting held at the Airedale Road sewer facility in Ridge. To summarize this meeting, they, along with county and state agencies, have sabotaged the Airedale Road sewage facility and connected it to drain in the Chesapeake Bay. The resource is getting worse because of this and not better. The watermen raise concerns about pollution and weak permits and are usually ignored. Here is an example of what can and does happen. I was concerned about waterways pollutant from land. Greg Clerick, MDE, asked for a meeting with Dwayne Potter, Metcom, and my neighbor, Buzz's Marina, and I to discuss pollution problems.
Mr. Dean, once again, I'm calling you down. No, this is not a court of law.
All right,
now,
sir, I'll try to read this as
here,
best I can.
We're here talking about a public boat ramp usage for water quality leasing.
Well, County Commissioner, if we don't have water quality, it's no sense
no,
in talking
keep,
about
let's keep
the
it,
leases.
Let's keep it up. We understand water quality.
Okay. The problem I was concerned about was actually the sediment pond. Buzz's Marina constructed in 2009.
Mr. Dean, once again, I'm going to tell you, sit down. Enough's enough.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to submit this for the record.
Fine. You can go ahead and do that. That's enough's enough. Next, we have Mr. Tom Daugherty.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Yes, sir.
Tom Daugherty, 46619 Millstone Landing Road, Lexington Park, Maryland. Thank you, Commissioners, for holding this hearing. DNR has a program for securing shoreline duct lines. Homeowners who have waterfront property are given an opportunity to buy a license. If they do not do that, then it goes to a lottery and is open to others. This seems to work well. I think this would work well for oyster leases. Give homeowners the right of first refusal and an opportunity to obtain oyster leases with the understanding that they must be developed in a viable oyster restoration program. I have lived on the Patuxent River for over 60 years. During this time, I've water skied, boated, crabbed, fished, and walked along the shoreline. And so have my children and grandchildren, and numerous others who I don't even know but can see every day. The column oyster leases, as presented, appear to be a safety hazard for people who engage in these water activities. Most importantly, I'm concerned about the use of commercial marinas as a stepping stone for offloading oysters. That need to be transferred elsewhere. I believe this is a potential health hazard, and I think now is the time to have this discussion, not after a tragedy occurs. And I ask that you support the moratorium. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, Teresa, is that Coon? Okay. Teresa, is that Coon? Is that right? Okay, I'm sorry. Okay.
Just real quick, while people are speaking, I know that you might want to have side conversations, but these microphones are very sensitive, so they pick everything up. So if you're speaking, you're going to be, it's whatever you're saying is being picked up and put over the other speakers. So, and we can, it comes right into our ear here as well. So just to keep that in mind. So if you want to have a side conversation, just do me a favor and please step outside.
All good?
You got it. Your time starts.
Great. Good evening. My name is Teresa Kuhns. I serve as the Government Affairs Director of Southern Maryland Association of Realtors. We represent 1,800 members and serve as the voice of property owners across our region, as well as the state and federal levels. Our organization fully supports the watermen of Southern Maryland and the oyster industry, which has a long, rich history in our state and directly impacts the economy here in St. Mary's County. As we represent property owners and property rights, we too are concerned about the high rate of leases being granted and its impact on the environment, riparian rights, and notifications provided to both the owners and agents representing any affected property for purchase. In June, both myself and the Vice President of our board presented these concerns to our parent organization, the Maryland Realtors, and its Public Policy Committee. There was enough concern among its committee members that it established its own statewide task force to study this issue. The next steps involve a meeting with elected officials, the Department of Natural Resources, as well as property owners and watermen to address concerns and develop solutions together. Our hope is we will have the time to address these issues and determine an action plan to protect property owner rights and any concerns to the watermen, liability to our agents when selling a property with a lease. To that end, SMAR supports this effort while we hope to be part of the solution at the end of the day. And thank you to the county commissioners for putting it out there.
Thanks very much. Joseph and Melinda Pagler. I'm sure I murdered your name, but.
Good evening, Commissioners. We are Joe and Melinda Pagliarani, 45485, Mount Olive Way, Valley Lee. We currently have an oyster lease in the application process through the Maryland Department of DNR for a 4-acre lease in the Patuxent River. Our proposed lease is located close to Commissioner Morgan's home. In order to work our lease, we would need to utilize a commercial dock or pier. Our operation would start very small and hopefully grow to have as many as 150,000 oysters. But those oysters would have a tremendous impact on the Patuxent River by filtering pollutants from over 7.5 million gallons of water a day. It is not our intention to harm anyone's beautiful waterfront property. It is rather to continue a St. Mary's County tradition of working the water while improving the health of our river and to maintain a small business that will employ local people. The proposed moratorium would greatly impact our ability to accomplish our vision. We are against it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sybil Tolson? Hey, ma'am, how you doing?
Hi, it's Sybil Tolson. It's 48868 Curley's Road, and that's property on Calvert Creek in Ridge, Maryland. After reading the Bay Journal article about this hearing last week, I want to say explicitly that our water view is not yet affected by water column oyster leases in front of our property. I am not an aggrieved party in that respect. Rather, my access to Calvert Bay is likely to be impinged upon by the 8.6-acre lease directly in front of our creek mouth. My recreational enjoyment of the bay is likely to be affected by the nearly 27-acre lease along the shoreline. It's disingenuous, perhaps wrong, to assert that the conflict over aquaculture in this county stems from the fact that property owners value their water views over the environmental benefits of aquaculture. Two major points are lost in this particular framing of the issue. First, the impact of floating water column leases is far different from bottom oyster leases in terms of balancing competing interests of public waters, in terms of balancing competing uses of public waters, intrusion on water views, general aesthetics, and documented environmental benefits. Second, commercial oyster leaseholders can get significant financial benefits from the use of public property. Specifically, water column leaseholders will enjoy their financial benefit from the primarily sole use of public property at the expense of others who have traditionally enjoyed access to that water. Many of us think the state is selling control over public water for far too little money. Annual rent for a water column lease is $25 per acre, which is a de minimis fee in light of the money-making potential awarded to an individual entity by virtue of the oyster lease. People who own waterfront homes in this county are rightly concerned that the explosion of water column leases will affect the resale value of their homes. Time will tell about the validity of that concern. In the meantime, the state has not considered property tax rebates for homeowners directly affected by the oyster leases. Adding insult to injury, while the state could assess a surcharge on oyster farm leaseholders to fund grants designed to encourage aquaculture development, currently no fee is imposed. Ironically, property tax revenue is used to fund the state's aquaculture business development grants. Aside from water access and financial issues, I'm concerned about the possible negative environmental impact of water column leases in Calvert Bay. As noted in the 2004 Chesapeake Bay Oyster Management Plan, the effects on any ecosystem of off-bottom aquaculture are site-specific and influenced by environmental conditions. At that point, there were few quantitative measures and more ecologically relevant studies of off-bottom aquaculture were needed. I have not found any studies in the interim that examine the ecological impact of water column leases in shallow waters, particularly with respect to the potential increase in aquatic microplastic penetration associated with plastic oyster floats. I think such studies are warranted. I'm out of time. For these reasons and others, such as the lack of transparency and accountability, I encourage the county commissioners to become involved to the extent practical in the state's oyster lease permit award process. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, ma'am. Next is Lisa Medenza.
Good evening. My name is Lesha Manzia, and I own waterfront property on Calvert Creek at 48868 Curly's Road in Ridge, Maryland. I'm a novice kayaker and canoer. I am concerned that my access out of Calvert Creek will be impeded by the 8.6-acre lease that was recently awarded. I'm also very concerned about the navigational hazards associated with a 27-acre lease along the shoreline. I believe that the safety issues for recreational boaters associated with the obstacles inherent in floating water column leases have been minimized, if not dismissed, by the state. While DNR encourages lease applicants to proactively engage with neighbors to uncover additional issues to consider, such as offshore blinds or local recreational boating activities, this did not happen in our case. The application for leases in Calvert Bay misrepresented our situation. It stated that there were very few neighbors to possibly offend. There was little to no boat traffic in shallow waters near shore and no recreational water use in our bay. DNR is charged with encouraging oyster production and does not adequately consider whether competing uses are compromised. I'm concerned that the state does not actively monitor leaseholders for compliance with the conditions of their permit. I'm also concerned these conditions are minimal at best. Importantly, DNR does not make it easy for others, including property owners, to understand what conditions have been imposed. Basic information on program operations is not readily available to the public. As an example, DNR does not compile and publish information from the required monthly harvest reporting sheets. At most, I can find out three leaseholders in Ridge, Maryland are late in submitting their March reports. I cannot find out if any leaseholders have been fined, or indeed if they are really subject to fines for non-reporting or other compliance issues. I understand from the Bay Journal article that 20% of the oyster leases issued in Maryland are for water column leases. A slightly higher percentage, 25%, of the leases in this county are water column leases. I think that looking at the acreage or size of the leases is a better measure to understand whether St. Mary's County has a disproportionate share of water column leases. This fundamental question cannot be easily answered by information on DNR's website. I applaud the commissioner's interest in this area and would encourage any actions that would increase transparency concerning the private use and commercial benefit from public property. I support actions that would slow the careless encouragement of water column leases. Thank you for holding this hearing.
Thank you, ma'am. Sandra Chasten.
Hi, my name is Sandy Chason. I live at 48760 Curly's Road in Ridge, Maryland. I am waterfront property owner. I want to thank you all, first of all, for the opportunity to listen to our concerns tonight on both sides of this. It's obviously there's a lot of things to be considered. I know your focus right now is on the commercial use, but I do want to echo the other concerns here about the limitation of navigation to homeowners. I also live on Calvert Creek, and everything that was said here applies to us also, that our ability to use the water is going to be greatly diminished as these leases start to be far or grown out outside of the mouth of our creek. More than that, I'm also very concerned about the public use, and I know that's the focus today, of the public infrastructure for private use. Quite frankly, I think that's not right that private for-profit companies can use public infrastructure, and then the burden of that maintenance and repair really goes to the county. And I would hope that through whatever mechanisms the county has, that it realizes and tries to quantify what that impact is and then appropriately assesses fees or taxes or whatever the right mechanism is to the users that basically if you're going to be generating revenue using public infrastructure, well, you should pay for that support and taxes or fees or however you want to term it, so that the burden doesn't go to the overall county residents for that. The other concern I have with the use of public landings or docks is that the balance between the use of the companies versus that of the recreational users, would there be any sort of limits as to time, like perhaps on weekends and holidays, that they would not be allowed to offload or unload while other people more than likely are going to want to be using these public piers? And I think finally, from what we were hearing tonight, maybe there needs to be better definition of what docks are actually are to be included in this ordinance. You know, I'm really most concerned about those that are commercial and for public use, not necessarily those that are private in front of somebody's home, because I too have one and I wouldn't want to be in that situation if I wanted to pursue this type of activity outside my own house. But I hope that you all will take these things into consideration, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, ma'am. Johnny Shockley, is that right?
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Johnny Shockley. I'm from Dorchester County, straight across the bay. Thank you for allowing this meeting tonight and giving both sides a chance to voice their positions.
What's your address, sir?
My address is 4846 Laurie Lane, Wolford, Maryland.
Okay.
I'm here with the Oyster Shellfish Growers Association, East Coast Shellfish Growers Association, and the association is in opposition to the moratorium. The East Coast Shellfish Growers Association represents over 1,400 shellfish farmers from Maine to Florida who collectively harvest over $150 million worth of sustainable grown shellfish while providing thousands of jobs in rural coastal communities. Last year, Maryland oyster growers produced over 20 million oysters worth about $6.5 million in farm gate value, while providing an estimated 600 jobs. As we know, a large part of those jobs and that revenue came from out of this county. Shellfish aquaculture also provides well-documented environmental benefits, as we do have, they are filter feeders. We're at the cusp of actually being able to use oysters to mitigate nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment. And oyster aquaculture has been approved by the EPA as a best management practice, which will open up enormous economy and jobs and opportunity to the waterman communities around the bay. We understand the waters of the state are a common property resource, and we acknowledge that not every proposed site is appropriate for aquaculture. We also do not dispute that riparian owners are justified to have reasonable, unfettered access to the navigational waters off their shores. However, this matter should be resolved without recourse to a moratorium with a questionable basis in law and policy. I will say that I think the best way forward is the Tiger Group that has been formed by the Department of Natural Resources to work out these differences, and that without the moratorium, this process has already been established. Now I'm going to put my waterman hat on. I am from Dorchester County. I'm a third-generation waterman. I spent most of my life from the time I was 9 years old until I was in my teens, right off the shores from Point Lookout to Point Lookin to St. Jerome's Creek on the boat with my father and my mother, crabbing and dreaming about how I was going to become a waterman on the Chesapeake Bay. I became a waterman on the Chesapeake Bay and spent a wonderful career in that as I watched it deter year after year after year. To a point in 2010, I was about ready to walk away from the seafood industry because I saw no future in it. At that point in time, we developed a leasing program in the state of Maryland that provided the course to recreate a new direction for the seafood industry and the oyster industry, which was in 1885 was a $50 million industry. At those days, dollars, and employed 40,000 people. Economic foundation of this county was built upon those resources and that grassroots resource. As that oyster industry went away, so has the seafood industry gone away, to a point where we've gone through a 200-year revolution in the seafood industry, and at this point in time, it is a dying star. It's soon to become a black hole. Immediately, what I recognize with oyster aquaculture is a way to rebuild that foundation, that oyster industry foundation, which will, in turn, reestablish the seafood industry and provide stability to its continuation and allow young people to be able to become involved in the seafood industry, build real economic structure, and save the social element of the entire state of Maryland and Virginia. I strongly support or ask you to support the development of oyster aquaculture prudently, responsibly, and in a way that you can encourage the entire community to rally around it. It is to the best interest of this county, not only this county, to every county on the shores of the Chesapeake, to save the heritage of the seafood industry and to be able to find a way to celebrate it in the years to come. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ben Wexler?
Close.
I probably murdered that one, Tim.
You didn't murder, it's Ben Wexler.
Ben Wexler, okay.
Comments here.
Good, you know.
Mr. President, County Commissioners, thank you for your time today. My name is Benjamin Starbuck Wexler. I am a land use and environmental attorney with the law firm of Linos & Blocker out of Annapolis. And I think I'm likely the only person coming out of Annapolis to come down here to support this moratorium. I'd like to give you a quick background of the work that I've done. And just to be clear, I'm here on behalf of a group of property owners in St. Mary's County and would request the full 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm. You need your address of the law firm, please.
My address is 1 firm. Park Place, Suite 585, Annapolis, Maryland, 21401. Over the last 10 years or so, I and my firm have represented a number of waterfront property owners in St. Mary's County as well as in Worcester County, trying to navigate the DNR aquaculture lease program. As others have indicated, and Mr. Guy, President Guy, in your opening remarks, you indicated as well, the process is difficult in that if a lease applicant meets the enumerated statutory criteria, DNR's position is that it must issue the water column lease. There is no opportunity for waterfront property owners, for recreational users, or really anyone else to challenge it or have standing or participate in any meaningful fashion with regard to the issuance of the lease. If the criteria are met, DNR must issue. That, however, does not mean that the county commissioners, either here or county council or the various county land use authorities, are powerless to participate in this process. While DNR has regulatory authority over waters of the state, the county commissioners have authority over the land. And with regard to the use, the land use and zoning restrictions on the land, including the docks and piers there, extending therefrom, the commissioners have the authority to address those issues. And that is strongly supported in this moratorium. And that is the approach that I would ask on behalf of my group of property owners to take a hard look at this and take a hard look at whether or not the various commercial marine zones in the county are appropriate for the expansion of industrial aquaculture. So, you know, I would say that as a starting point, and I'm going to be mindful of your comments, this is not a court of law, I'm going to keep it brief. The notion of moratoria is very well established in both federal and state law. The Supreme Court has sanctioned moratoria in a number of jurisdictions in order to tap the brakes, to have a cooling off period. And the state courts, including the Maryland appellate courts, have strongly supported the notion that when there is a large and expanding industry that may negatively impact land use at the local level, it is squarely within the authority. It's the apex of local police authority and land use authority to impose a moratorium to tap the brakes so everybody can take a step back, take a look at what's working, what's not working, and impose reasonable rules and regulations, can convene meetings like this, have a discussion with all the stakeholders and to figure out how to address it. That is all that this moratorium does. It's not permanent. It's 18 months to give everybody an opportunity to slow down the pipeline, to take a look at this issue, and look at what the land use implications are going to be with regard to a rapidly expanding industrial aquaculture industry. Two points, I saw the comment letter from the Chesapeake Bay Foundation implicitly conceding that the county commissioners have authority to address these issues. They've raised some what I think are fairly spurious constitutional arguments with regard to the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment and the Commerce Clause. In my written comments, I've gone through this. I don't think there's any basis in this, but obviously you guys are free to rely on your counsel. I guess my final thing that I would like to raise is that there are a lot of issues that can be addressed here and can be addressed with DNR. There is a common ground here, and every single person I have spoken with loves oysters, loves aquaculture, loves the water quality benefits that are associated with aquaculture, and is very supportive of economic development. The Bay is a big place. The state program can be working a whole lot better. The county can take whatever means it feels is appropriate to regulate the land impacts. And under the circumstances, would really strongly encourage you to support this moratorium, tap the brakes, and take a hard look at this issue and continue this dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Deb Raley.
Hi, I'm Deborah Raley. I live at 48754 Curley's Road in Ridge, Maryland. I want to thank you for the opportunity to speak this evening. As you can tell, there are a lot of people here from the Calvert Bay, Calvert Creek area because we just recently lost our efforts to stop a lease in Calvert Bay. So I have a lot of the same concerns that other property owners have. But I want to talk about, from our experience, we had a four-year dispute. It was not in favor of either party. It took long to resolve this, both from the aquaculture lease and the homeowner. So it was nothing that any of us wanted to go through, and something I hope none of you in this room have to go through again. What we found, what I learned from the process, so there were some positives, is that first of all, the Maryland law does not require formal notification for all affected parties for leases. It only has to notify those that are property is adjacent to the lease. Those of us on Calvert Creek have to access, have ingress into the creek through Calvert Bay. So the mouth of our creek fronts Calvert Bay. We were not notified through the formal process. Second of all, competing interests don't matter. Third, the riparian homeowner has no rights. What it left us with was a lot of unanswered questions. You heard a lot of people here talking tonight about navigation and safety issues. We still have concerns about navigating our small watercraft in that Calvert Bay area. We also never got any answers to impact the property values. There are a lot of concerns that went unaddressed. I heard some folks here tonight talk about the formula for cages. Well, I can't answer that because we never got an answer during our four-year adventure. But I can tell you that in the 38 acres that was approved in Calvert Bay, there were 8,300 cages going in that space. I heard someone here tonight say the average is a 3-acre water column lease per year. Well, I guess St. Mary's County should get a punt for the next 13 years because we just gave 38 acres to the aquaculture adventure. The other thing I want to say is the cages in the shallows. I'm not sure what the answer should be to that, what should be an acceptable depth. I know that crab pots have to be 2 foot below the surface, which allows you to navigate over them. I have no concerns about the crab potters in the area. I have no concern about oysters on the bottom. I can navigate over that. I do have concerns when you have the shallows and the cages going in the shallows. And the map that we got from DNR, it's an August 2015 map, shows that the lease is going into shallows that are 0.8 feet, which is 9.5 inches, to 2.3 feet in the mean low water. We all know that the cages are 18 inches in depth, so that means we're going to have exposed cages, which leaves us with a bunch of other unanswered questions. We had a lease, a current working lease in Calvert Bay for 5 acres. We as homeowners did not challenge that. We did our part for aquaculture. The cages are further out from shore. We can navigate over them at high tide. At low tide, not always. The cages are exposed. The new leases are going into even more shallow waters. So you can only imagine what it is. So this isn't about view. The last thing I want to end this with saying, I attended the critical area meeting last week, and the state presenter stated that the critical area includes all land under the waters. I encourage you commissioners to actively engage in the future of aquaculture, because this is a bigger issue than what we do with our commercial docks. This is what we want to be, the Wild West of aquaculture in St. Mary's County, specifically looking at water column leases on the land under the waters surrounding St. Mary's County. I leave you with this question. If there is a shoreline critical area designation of 1,000 feet to protect our natural resources from the property owners, why is there not an offshore critical area designation to protect the land under these waters? Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, is it a Rick Meat Yard? Rick Meat Yard?
Yes, sir. I'm Rick Meat Yard. I'm 18521 Herring Creek Road in Tall Timbers, Maryland. I'm here, I'm representing the commercial marine and aquaculture industry. I'm the president of the Tall Timbers Development Company, which is part of Tall Timbers Marina, and co-founder of the Double T Oyster Ranch, LLC, which is located on Herring Creek, adjacent to the Tall Timbers Marina. We use water column method of raising our oysters. I'm confused as to why commercial marine is being punished during this process. We follow the zoning regulations as written in the zoning code for commercial marine. You can read the permitted activities, all of which are affected by this moratorium, ranging from boat ramps, fuel sales, dockage, wharfage, boat repair, aquaculture, restaurant, education, the list goes on and on. This moratorium will reach into our 2020 season and will without a doubt affect the bottom line of our financial statement. It will have an effect on economic growth, development, and job growth for both commercial marine and aquaculture programs. When the comprehensive plan was drawn up, aquaculture was really not an issue. The bay oyster industry had been devastated by diseases, MSX and Dermo, and it is still recovering from that, and within part by the aquaculture program supported by the University of Maryland, University of Virginia, Department of Natural Resources, and the Chesapeake Bay Foundation. Now is the time for our county commissioners to embrace and support aquaculture for economic growth, job growth, tourism, and education. The moratorium is not in the best interest to promote health, safety, and welfare for the commercial marine properties, nor the Chesapeake Bay and the tributaries. Properly studied, managed, and promoting aquaculture will be an asset for St. Mary's County. Aquaculture is part of the St. Mary's County culture. Aquaculture and agriculture served as the main job market before the Patuxent River program. We understand that there is an issue with water columns. However, there is a long and lengthy process to to secure permits and leases that the public is welcome to participate in. Recreation, commercial marine, agriculture, and aquaculture can exist in harmony and build a better Chesapeake Bay. One oyster actually filters 50 gallons of water daily. You can do the math. If better communication between the county and DNR is needed, then do it. Do not keep this moratorium, which is jeopardizing the momentum and progress that has begun to save the oysters in the Chesapeake Bay watershed. I thank you for this moment. Appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. Is it Larry Jennings?
It is.
Am I saying that right?
Good evening, Commissioner Guy, members, the other members of this commission. I'm Larry Jennings, 960 Woodland Circle, Annapolis, Maryland. I'm here representing CCA Maryland, that's the Coastal Conservation Association, nationwide association from the state of Washington all the way around through the Gulf and Maine. Pretty much every state, over 120,000 members nationwide. As recreational anglers, we want to see more fish in the water for us to catch. And oysters are a very big part of the Chesapeake Bay ecology and is important for the fish, the crabs, the shrimps, and everything else in that ecosystem. Many of you have obviously now become much more educated on that process and what these particularly water column leases are doing. What you are probably still not yet aware of is how abundant life is amongst these water column cages and floats. If you should ever be with one of them, have them take the bag out of the cage or the float and dump it on your dock or the boat. It's astounding how much life is in there close to these oysters. It's protected space. The small shrimps, minnows, crabs are all able to feed inside these cages. They are packed with life. They are emulating what originally dominated in this bay, three-dimensional oyster reefs that protected our shorelines. If the lady previously with the 2,000 square feet of shoreline had understood it, she would go with oyster floats and cages to protect her shoreline. She would not have to pay for all the rock that would go there. That really is not a long-term solution to a living shoreline. If she protected that shoreline with cages and floats, the waves would be flattened and the erosion would stop and in fact start accreting soil to protect that shoreline. We've had one float operator in Maryland who's been around a long time. They had to move their lease because there was no longer enough water underneath it to get good circulation. That circulation is what makes these water column oysters grow so fast. The tides flow, they are up in it, they are closer to the sun where the algae is most dense, and they feed quickly. That's why these oysters are ready for the market in 9 to 14 months generally, depending upon where they are. They grow fast. That means they're taking those algae out of the water 2 to 3 times as fast as on bottom leases. And yet, statewide, there is just 400 acres of water column leases in Maryland. They are producing a tremendous product. As you said, you've seen it around the country. They are selling all around the country. It's a shame that the fear of the unknown and misinformation are really rampant here, and I hope you will do all you can to stop this law from going through. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Doug Myers.
Good evening, Mr. President, member of the commission. My name is Doug Myers. I live at my address that I've put is 6 Herndon Drive, Annapolis. It's the headquarters of Chesapeake Bay Foundation. I'm the Maryland senior scientist. Thank you for your time tonight. I'd like to go through a few points, and I'd also like to give you a second printed copy of our letter, because I think the PDF version we sent electronically had some issues on the front page, so.
I think we got those copies, but we'll make sure we generate them out again.
If you tried to print it, it was going to work. Sure. So I'm going to start with a few points and then go through some of the larger points from the letter that we sent. And I want to make sure you understand Chesapeake Bay Foundation's position in this. Waterfront property owners are our largest donors. And aquaculturists are our most strident advocates for water quality. So we have both of those constituents weighing in on this from the standpoint of our 240,000 members in six states and the District of Columbia. The moratorium would halt any data points that you would be trying to collect about the effect of new leases. As a scientist, I'd like to know that I have data points in order to evaluate the effect of something. So stopping the activity for a period of time where you don't have any data points informing that is just bad science. The ordinance does not accomplish the changes of notification procedures that are stated as the reason for this ordinance. I think that is a valid argument that needs to be made with DNR, but this ordinance does not accomplish that. It seems counterintuitive that the local government would take such an action as a step to curtail economic development, as I believe one of your economic development plans for the county actually seeks to expand aquaculture. You've heard from Mr. Jennings just previously about water column leases in those cages to be able to filter the algae. And I'd like to explain to you that that life that he mentions, I call it cage scum or biofilm. It's literally millions and millions of marine organisms that are also filtering the water in addition to the oysters themselves. And it is full of edible particles that are feeding fish, crabs, shrimps, and other organisms. So the cages themselves not only have a higher filtration capacity because you have a higher number of oysters that can take up a smaller amount of bottom space, but you're also producing food for the ecosystem at a much accelerated rate. Water column leases from floating cages are removed periodically from the water and cleaned to remove that biofilm. This has been termed by some of the conversation around this as industrial activity. I think that's a misnomer. I think cleaning those cages is a regular routine maintenance. It doesn't take very long, it doesn't happen very often, and it's a necessary process. Enforcement of this ordinance seems almost impossible. I don't know if the commission intends to have somebody on the dock asking people whether or not the seafood they're attempting to land is coming from Wild Harvest, an existing lease, or one of the new leases. So I don't think the ordinance really understands what the enforcement capacity is for that. And the ordinance appears to attempt by waterfront property owners to actually own Chesapeake Bay. And I know there's some statements in our letter about some of the legal concerns we have about that. Riparian rights are pretty specific in the state of Maryland, and they do not include a protection of an unobstructed view. So with that, I'm going to finish with a few salient points from the letter. Prior to 2009, establishment of the viable oyster industry in Maryland was greatly hindered by piecemeal statutes and regulations that hampered aquaculture businesses, including county moratoria just like this one. And we've tried to change that by having a comprehensive statewide aquaculture leasing program. To do that, we wanted to relieve the pressure on the Wild Harvest. There is significant reduction in the Wild Harvest stocks, and Chesapeake Bay Foundation, along with other groups, is forcing the Department of Natural Resources to do a stock assessment for the oysters in the bay because we had been harvesting them for hundreds of years without knowing how many there were. We do know that there's been a significant decrease in wild oyster harvest landings, and there's been a corresponding increase in aquaculture to try to meet the demands of the seafood industry. There were comments made at the August 7th meeting of the Maryland Aquaculture Council to try to reflect the intent of the ordinance. And I wanted to clarify that the leases pending or issued in St. Mary's County since 2015, more than 50% were issued to current watermen holding a commercial fishing license. So this is augmenting their their lost revenue from the fact that the aquaculture is taking up the slack from their lost harvest from the wild population. So thank you for your time. I do want to stress that the Chesapeake Bay Foundation opposes this moratorium. Thank you.
Thank you. Audrey Swanberg, is that right? Okay.
More people from up the road.
Hi, I'm Audrey Swanberg. My address is 6 Herndon Avenue in Annapolis. That's again the Chesapeake Bay Foundation headquarters. Thank you for the opportunity to comment. I'm speaking here today on behalf of the Chesapeake Oyster Alliance. We're a broad coalition of 45 nonprofits, community organizations, business leaders, and academic partners. We're committed to adding 10 billion new oysters to the bay by 2025. And the realization of this goal, with both its economic and ecological benefits, is dependent on a robust dedication to oyster restoration and a continued annual increase of the aquaculture business sector here in Maryland. As many people before me have mentioned, oyster aquaculture provides numerous benefits, including for water quality. And I just want to reemphasize that it's recently been approved by the Chesapeake Bay Program as a best management practice for the removal of nitrogen and phosphorus to help counties achieve their WIP 3 goals. Furthermore, expansion of oyster aquaculture helps diversify economic development. This moratorium arbitrarily discriminates against younger enterprises and would have a chilling effect on the economic growth of this business sector. As a recommendation, we encourage the members of the DNR Aquaculture Working Group representing St. Mary's County to work with the department to ensure adequate representation of all aquaculture sectors, as well as ample opportunities for the entire public to comment and provide input on whatever the recommendations are from that work group. We all agree, we want better water quality, we want, you know, local business development. However, these benefits are restricted with this proposed ordinance. So as such, the policy committee of the Chesapeake Oyster Alliance opposes the proposed moratorium. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Tyle Petty, Hollywood Oyster Company.
Good evening, Commissioner Guy. Good evening, everybody. I'm Tal Petty, Hollywood Oyster Company. Address is 44149 Tranquility Farm Lane in Hollywood, Maryland. I'm against this proposal. This is rushed and unnecessary legislation. It's always good to listen to concerns. I'm certainly hearing that education needs to occur as our aquaculture industry grows. Oyster farms require an incredible amount of process for approval that address the concerns raised this evening. You've also heard other processes mentioned that are open to you, Commissioner. Oyster aquaculture is a prioritized industry in this same commission's economic development plan to diversify our economy. I would like to suggest that concerned property owners visit some oyster farms and communicate with us and educate themselves to address issues and questions rather than legislate against us. I heard a lot of areas of concern that need education and that are fears tonight. An 18-month moratorium is not tapping the brakes. I'd like to say that again. An 18-month moratorium is not tapping the brakes. It is a huge roadblock on a growing industry that is providing jobs and diversifying our economy as prioritized by this same commission. A moratorium is not the answer to addressing these concerns. Thank you for your time.
Mr. Petty, before you said, how many people do you employ?
I employ 15
people. 15 people right now?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Jim Bradley.
Good
Hi, my name is Jim Bradley. I live at 22879 Bradley Farm Lane, Lexington Park. And I just have a few questions. When I look at this, what DNR is doing, I'm wondering if they are aware of all the recreational things that are not being factored into the oyster leases. Water skiing, they have laws out there that say you have to stay beyond 100 feet of a shore, pier, bridges, people on the water, or other vessels. Does this apply to the oyster leases? What happens at night? It's a safety issue. I watched the fireworks over at Solomon's with this huge armada of boats, and when they disperse, they just go off into the night, and they go right by where some of these leases are proposed. And I'm wondering if, it's a question, are there areas of the counties, like the Lower Patuxent River, where the density of boating activity doesn't warrant oyster lease or leases like in that area? Because we have a lot of boat traffic there. There's not many areas where people can get out and water ski and so forth. So, and I do have one other question. If there's a lease in place in front of a property owner and he or she wants to put a pier in, would they be able to go out, say, 200 feet, or would they be restricted by the existing lease? So I'm just throwing that out as a question. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Robert T. Brown.
Robert T. Brown. I live at 38232 Palmer Road, Colton's Point, Maryland. I am president of the Maryland Watermen's Association. I'm also a leaseholder in St. Mary's County, and all my leases are bottom leases by choice because that's the way I wanted to do it. There's also room enough for both of us, the water columns and the bottom leases in the county. When the lease laws went into effect, or back in, if you want to go back to 2003, our commercial harvest was down to 26,000 bushels per year, the lowest that it has ever been recorded. That caused the Department of Natural Resources and the governor's office up there to take management plans to ensure that we had oysters. One of them was a sanctuary plan. Another one was lease bottom. When the lease bottom went in, well, first of all, when the sanctuary bottom went in, they took 25% of our bottom. But it was 75% of our most productive bottom. And one of the ideas that they had was to make leasing go ahead quicker was they opened up more power dredging bottom for us in the lower part of the bay, which we wanted. And a lot of the scientists came out and said, well, 3 or 4 years, they'll be to wipe all the oysters out down there. And we'll be able to go ahead full blast with aquaculture. And little did they know that with us power dredging and bringing the shells out and having natural strikes down in there, we went from 26,000 bushel to over 400,000 bushel in a matter of about 3 or 4 years. And that just goes to show you how cultivating the bottom and working it how it should go. Well, at the same time, when the leasing laws went in effect, they have a few criterias that, you know, you had to have riparian rights 50 foot offshore, 150 foot from a beacon or marked channel, you can't go in SAV beds, you got to stay over Yates Bar, and it was a couple more to it. Anyhow, there was no protection put in for our clammers and our crabbing industry. The crab, mostly the trot liners, especially over in Dorchester County, They have a lot of these coming up, and they were losing a lot of the ground that they had on. Not all of it, but, you know, they were missing some of it. In St. Mary's County, we had our clambers over here who lost bottom. Some of it was the bottom leases, some of it was the cages. It was some of each in both areas. And it's not right, in my opinion, when you have an existing business, another one come and take it over. And what we, the problem, where we are at now, and this is, a lot of this stuff is not what we asked for. It was just shoved right on us with the sanctuaries and the other stuff. What we have now is, number one of the worst things they had when they were doing this, there was not a proper notification on it at all. Nobody knew nothing until a lease was just pretty much a done deal. Well, the department hearing this past year has came back and they went around to all the counties and asked them what they wanted the County Waterman Association, what were the problems, to try to work it out. And they came up and went around to all the counties and they came back and now they've came up with a tiger team, so they're calling it. And Commissioner Guy, you're on it. I've seen Commissioner Morgan up there at two of the meetings. And I'm also on that commission also, or that committee. And we're trying to work together to try to smooth the edges out and get this so we can all work together. And we need to let that process go through because oysters are valuable to all of us. Also, when it comes to this, a person with a private pair maybe not being able to land his aquaculture oysters, or this, if you're a commercial marine, you don't do it. You know, commercial marine is a private entity that people have built around the water edges for life, their entire life. And they have a right to conduct their business, and this is part of these people's businesses. Now, I'll be the first one to tell you that there are all problems that we have into it. And the department now is working, trying to correct them. Who knows how that, well, that's going to work out. Hopefully we can solve most of the problems. We won't solve them all. I do want to comment on the health of oysters because I heard it brought up here earlier today. Our health department is so tight on us on oysters. Right now, if we had aquaculture is taking up oysters during the month of August, we have to have them under refrigeration by 10:30. Also, you got to, when they come in, you got to have your cool room down to less than 45 degrees. You got to have them in there 1 hour. And the oysters have got to be brought down below 50 degrees before you can take and put them on a truck. And the truck's got to be, make sure it's down to around 45 degrees. So, I mean, I don't want no people to get a false idea that the health department is not doing their job, because they are. And the last thing that the oyster industry needs is somebody getting sick. I think it's time for us to see what this committee comes out with and works out on it. Hopefully we can make progress to straighten some of these problems out. But these piers got to be protected, and especially now, as far as the public piers and your public ramps, that's one thing, but this commercial marine person's got a right to, you know, keep working, and the private payers. Some places is not a good place for leasing because the bottom's not good. It's the same way for cages, you know, much not good on that. So take careful consideration in planning what you do and give Annapolis enough time to work this out if you could. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Brian Norris.
Excuse me. Brian Norris, 40115 Coombs Creek Way in Leonardtown. Also have 16012 Smith Creek House Lane in Ridge. The subject of a 4 year ago application for an 80 acre water column lease. I would have to applaud the county commissioners on you've done exactly what needed to be done in the fact that you've raised awareness. You brought people together that the whole time we were fighting the 80-acre lease that got moved down to 27 didn't come together and have this kind of dialogue. But as a dock owner, as a former waterman from Ridge, I can't support a moratorium on a private gentleman's pier where he's trying to make a living if he's got a lease in process. DNR wants to give away everything. 80 acres, that's a huge lease. But two wrongs don't make a right. Shutting him down, it's not going to fix it. But you have raised awareness. So, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Norris. Susan Smith.
I yield the floor.
I think it says Robert Pryor. Did I say it wrong? 23359 Green Holly Road. Okay, going once, going twice. You're no longer speaking. Okay. Next, Cindy Jones. Cindy Jones is a former commissioner of St. Mary's County.
Good evening, Cindy Jones, 46241 Usher Lane. I'm here tonight to offer some insight, perhaps. I hope my comments will be helpful to everybody in the room. Having sat in that chair for 4 years and dealt with bureaucracies in Annapolis on a number of occasions, probably the issue most pertinent to this is Plan Maryland, another land use issue. One of the concerns I've always had is the lack of accountability, transparency, with the way the bureaucracies that are run out of Annapolis respond to county concerns. I don't know enough about this issue to tell you yes, a moratorium is a good thing or no, it isn't. But I can tell you, as a county commissioner dealing with issues such as this in land use and the powers that be in Annapolis, it's very frustrating as a commissioner to try and do what's right for the people that you're elected to represent. And you find when you open your toolbox, you have very limited tools to help protect the interests of the people that you're elected to represent. Private property is essential to a peaceful and prosperous county. And the business owners in this case have a right for their property rights to be protected. The property owners have the right for their property rights interest to be protected. I'm concerned that if there's no lever, no pressure exerted locally by the Board of County Commissioners, that the powers that be in Annapolis can simply look the other way, can continue to whistle past the graveyard, and drag this out interminably and not make hard decisions that are going to have to be made by somebody. Decisions are going to have to be made. And if you do nothing to hold them accountable, to exert the local authority that you have, you are putting all of the marbles on that side of the table, and you don't have any on your own side anymore. So I can't tell you what you should do, but I can only offer you the insight of having been the person sitting in that chair and dealing with issues similar to this. Making this an issue, getting the dialogue going is very important. And also, everyone has to understand that a lot of communication has to take place, a lot of education has to take place, and a lot of meetings and a lot of things have to come together before a path forward that is acceptable to all parties concerned can go forward. This isn't going to happen quickly. So I just want to encourage everyone to stay positive. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jones. Brian, is it Brian Russell?
If you all are lucky. Good evening. My name is Brian Russell. I'm a third generation waterman and one of four owners and operators of Shore Thing Shellfish, a small oyster farm in Baltimore, Maryland. And I'm also the president of the Southern Maryland Shellfish Growers Association, so I'm asking for the 5 minutes I'm speaking.
Did you get your full address?
Oh, sorry. 45725 Stony Run Drive, Great Mills, Maryland. All right. So many call aquaculture a sustainable practice, but really oyster aquaculture is more than that. It's a restorative practice. So that means that oyster farms are helping to heal and restore the bay while also growing food for millions of people. The reason that I and my partner started oyster farming is because three of us had been working for the state seasonally doing oyster restoration, which we really enjoyed. So when the state changed the lease laws in 2009, we were intrigued and thought we could do more good as oyster farmers than as state employees to help restore the bay. So while making a living, so aquaculture is restoration, using private funds instead of taxpayer dollars. However, getting a lease is not as easy as going to the DNR, submitting an application, and walking away the same day. It took us three years to get a 2-acre water column lease without any homeowner objections. And that was just going through normal DNR process and Army Corps of Engineers process. Army Corps of Engineers protects the waterways, channels, and all navigable waters, and they also talk to National Marine Fisheries, EPA, and NOAA, and Coast Guard. So we're heavily regulated by federal and state. So a lease applicant is generally limited by public shellfish areas, or where wild harvest occurs. We're limited by seagrass areas, SAB zones. We're restricted by navigable channels, pound net sites, and restricted water quality areas, just to name a few of the obstacles we have to overcome just to get a lease. So DNR works with the leaseholder and other user groups to make sure that we aren't getting in each other's way. And that happens from time to time, but that usually they can work things out, and there is room enough out there for everybody. So we are not only regulated by DNR, the language in the proposed ordinance and moratorium addressing public health, safety, and welfare of county residents is already being taken care of by the state and at the state and federal level. FDA has strict regulations for shellfish farmers nationwide that are enforced by the State Department of Health. Once you get a lease, you have to go through a certification course and training. You have to become certified in safe shellfish handling. Then we have to keep detailed cooling and shipping records, which are checked by the state every 6 months. So during the summer, we have curfews. As Robert T. mentioned earlier, right now we have to have our oysters in the walk-in box by 10:30 in the morning, and they have to be cooled down within 10 hours under 50 degrees, or else we can't sell them. And then they have to go into a cool truck. They can't ever warm up from that point on, or else they have to go back in the water or be dumped somewhere. So there's been a lack of communication between the county and state agencies, and I understand that, and a lack on the oyster aquaculture industry, that's our part, that's the Growers Association part, of educating the public as to what aquaculture is all about. The language of the proposed moratorium states that the county staff need to study aquaculture in the county waters. A study can be done without hindering small local businesses. Also, this proposed moratorium stems from what we in aquaculture industry refer to as NIMBYism. Not in my backyard. Many of these waterfront landowners enjoy our oysters, but they don't want to see the process occurring off their property. They object to oyster farm because they fear it will either disrupt their view or interfere with their being able to recreate in that particular area. Most water column leases utilize on-bottom cages where the only thing visible is a buoy on top of the water and looks no different than a crab pot. And you can navigate over top of our cages just like you can over top crab pots. So you are also allowed to recreate anywhere in the bay. You're not limited by SAV zones or public shellfish areas or by water quality issues. So honestly, if you ever wanted to crab and fish recreationally, right next to an aquaculture water column lease is one of the best places to go, because our cages do provide the best habitat and safe haven for all kinds of fish and crabs. Oyster farms do more good for the bay than a homeowner living on the water. Our oysters are constantly removing the excess nutrients that run off from all land, and they are constantly taking out that nutrients and removing it. When we remove the oysters out of the water, you're actually taking that nutrients physically out of the water. And it's one of the best management practices approved by EPA. So I fear that if you hinder the growth of shellfish aquaculture, you're dooming the restoration of our bay and its tributaries. The Marylanders cannot afford to restore the bay on tax dollars alone. I'm almost done. The oysters we put in the water help to increase the number of oysters in the water every year at no cost to a taxpayer. So, and I also want to add that if any of the commissioners or anyone in this room ever want to come out to our farm, just give me a shout, Shore Thing Shellfish, www.shorethingshellfish.com, and just contact me, and we'd be glad to show you what we're all about. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next, Mr. Tucker Brown. Mr. Brown?
Mr. Chairman, thank you all very much for having this here tonight. And my address is 20840 Olden Mattingly Road, Avenue, Maryland, 20609. A lot has been said here tonight. I have a lease, a bottom lease. I'm 80 years old, and I go to work every single day. Get up at 2:30 every morning, and I work hard, and I can still stand with some of the best of them. I can tell you that. I come from the old school, and I do not make no excuses for it. I am not for cages. I do not feel that's the best way to go. It's so much that needs to be looked at into that part of it, because it's going to affect people around the shoreside, your tourism, your recreational. We have done so much work, and I will take the time now to thank the MWA for all their support that they and time that they have spent and put in to trying to get this worked out. We're up and down the road. I go when I can. But I'm going to tell you, this is a time that it needs to be aired out. We need time for this county, because I'll tell you exactly right now what will happen. You will not see, if this program keeps going and we can't get time to work things out, you will not see what you have out here right now again. It's just the way it is. This was shot all down on top of everybody, and it's not just here. The whole state of Maryland, the state of Virginia, it got so bad in the state of Virginia, they were even dropping the cages down on the beaches. And they had to form a commission. The commission in St. Mary's County and the Potomac is coming on with it. I chair the Shellfish Committee over there. We have a panel that's trying to work things out, what we're going to be looking at and doing in the Potomac for the next 20 years. And we are going slow, because this is a stumbling block. And believe me, it's real. We can work it out, but it's going to take some time. I support everything that Phil Dorsey had to say, the moratorium is most definitely needed so that it will solve problems further down this road. What about the people that come down to go skiing or put the kids on whatever that thing is that they got, that bowl? And this is the place to have it. We're on a peninsula down here. You know, Chesapeake Bay is a beautiful thing. That's how some classify it. But where are most of them at? Most of them are coming in your rivers. They want to be close to everything that they got. I would love to be able to work out of my home, too. I drive over Solomon's, and I work up into the river, and I start a half hour before sunup. So I have to get up early for all that to happen. We really have something here, but we need to bring everybody together. I don't blame the landowner for hollering, but they need to go through this too so that they can really see down the road what might be able to really get together. And I want to thank you again very much for your time and hoping that things can work so we get this time to really, and I think the state would really appreciate it too, because it's problems there. And there is room for both. We have tried to work with them and show them better places, but it doesn't always work that way. I thank you again very much.
Thank you, sir.
Is that it? Wait a minute, let's see here.
I have something to say.
Okay, that's the end of our list of those who signed up. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? We'll give you more time. Come forward, sir. All we need is a name and address, please.
My name is Joe Willanningham, 15942 Wynn Road and Ridge. County Commissioners, I'm here. My property is directly affected by the lease in front of my property. The 8.6 acres that just went in. My riparian rights, I have none. As far as the cages, someone said that you could drive over top of them. There's no way. There's no way. They shine all the time. They're never in place half the time. I have a hunting site out there. I don't know how you're supposed to hunt with cages all around you. Well, let's go fetch a duck. But on top of that, I got taxes to pay. You pay a lot of taxes on waterfront property. And I can't see paying high taxes when you don't really have waterfront property. It's a lot of, when they first put the first 4 or 5 acres in, I didn't oppose it. I thought it was a good thing. And it's out there far enough where it didn't bother me. Like this gentleman here, if he wants to grow oysters by his pier or whatever he wants to do, that's fine. But they don't have to put it around mine. I have my own agenda, what I like to do. You pay taxes on it. You have the right to do what you like to do. But again, you know, you can't do but so much out there if you can't get over top the cages and so forth and so on. So that's basically all I got to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blanham. That's in Calvert Bay, right, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak at this time? Giving you opportunity here. We've had a lot of speakers tonight, and we appreciate everybody coming out here. But one more chance. Going once, going twice. Closed.
Randy, I got something.
Wait, I know that. That's all who have signed up to speak tonight.
Before they leave.
At this time, we'd like to give Commissioner O'Connor would like to say a few words before we close it up.
Before everybody takes off, I want to go ahead and I'm glad that everybody's here to have these discussions. First of all, it's the proposed moratorium that got us here. I don't know that we exactly needed an ordinance to spark this, but sometimes you have to light a fire to go ahead and get the other people in the room. I've been known to do that once or twice in my tenure here. All right. Sometimes it takes people being personally affected. All right. What I think we can all agree here is that the Department of Natural Resources is the issue. DNR didn't listen to St. Mary's citizens. They failed us. Secretary Belton did not listen. He's failing us. And the General Assembly and the Senate failed us. So we're sitting here having this discussion because of the failures of the people at the state to listen to everybody that is involved. I did hear about a practical approach, and I heard about reasonableness and balance. I want to clarify a few things on this ordinance, and like I said, I remain unusually quiet. There absolutely is no mechanism to enforce this whatsoever. We don't have it. There's no way to do it, all right? The definition of what a commercial dock is, for as is applicable to this, doesn't exist, all right? We cannot override the state law as far as these comm leases are concerned. So tomorrow, if a lease gets approved, and if this ordinance was approved, the columns are still gonna go up. They're still gonna have everything going on with the aquaculture, but it's gonna go to Calvert County, and that's where it's gonna get offloaded. So anybody here that owns property out there, this isn't gonna stop the column lease. That it isn't gonna do that. Me personally, the way I feel about this is that this is just words on a piece of paper. And ultimately, it was necessary to get Annapolis involved and get them listening, because Secretary Belton is actually listening now. So what I don't want to have happen here is we end up in a situation that was many, many years ago with like the Calvert Cliffs Nuclear Power Plant, whatever it's called now, where we say we don't want it in St. Mary's County, so we put it in Calvert County. And guess what? We still have to deal with all the negative impacts that come from there, but we lose all the economic development. We lose any of the benefits that Calvert County has, that multi-millions of dollars that has helped them grow and maintain their infrastructure. So there's a lot of balance that needs to be found. I don't want to lose the businesses in this county, and I want to make sure the property rights of everybody is protected. So because I've remained quiet on it, I just wanted everybody here to understand that, you know, these water columns are going to happen whether this passes or not. And personally, I don't see the need to even have this pass because it's not going to do a thing. However, what I will offer, and hopefully we can do it, is to continue this conversation to Annapolis. If we have to, and if we're allowed to legally, to get the STS buses, to put all of you in the buses, to go up there to see Secretary Belton, let's do it. Don't lose this momentum because you've started here locally. You've told us we're here to represent you, and I guarantee the people sitting at this table and those that aren't are going to continue to represent all of you in every single aspect of what you've brought forward here now. So I understand it's frustrating, but we will work this out appropriately with a proper balance, and I loved everything I heard here tonight, so thank you very much.
Well, in a second here, I'm going to go through that. What happens is we have this is the public hearing. We'll take the information we've gotten tonight, and it may change the ordinance. We have a time period where people can write in, email, whatever, to the commissioners. And then I think our next date is the 11th of September. We bring it up again. And we, the commissioners, have to make a decision rather than keep moving this forward, hold it, relook at it, whatever. Things have already started happening with this. Like I told you earlier, DNR all of a sudden started this. What did somebody call it? I called it a focus group, but they called it something else. But anyway, Tiger Team. And it was interesting. There was only really two county representatives at this meeting. That was St. Mary's County and Dorchester County, and a whole lot of watermen. And we learned very quickly that the law was already written by the legislators, and we don't have any rights in the waters of the state of Maryland. They're state of Maryland waters, period. And nobody else has rights to them except for the state of Maryland. And they can do what they want to do in DNR. My focus was, when I went to the first meeting on 1 August, I said, I believe we need to have really good open communications. Everybody needs to be informed about this and have and be better educated. I grew up in St. Mary's County. I understand orchards. My mother wanted a dozen orchards when I was just a young kid. I'd go out to Smith's Creek, wait around, and pick up a dozen oysters. That's how easy it was to get them then. That was a long time ago. We don't talk about that too much. But the thing of it is, I know things have changed, and this column leasing is something all new. And many of the store owners, property owners, started complaining to us about it. And I suppose that's where all this came about, and we started hitting DNR with, hey, look, what is the procedure for all this? What is going on? And it seemed like nobody in the county here really knew anything about it. When I asked fellow commissioners, were you ever informed when they passed this law 9 years ago? No. Nobody was involved, it seems like, in the creation of this column leasing. And I got to admit, I dug into it real quick and tried to find, get more knowledge about it. And I know just from the experience that my brother lives on Cockle Creek, growing oysters in these floaters is a great idea. We've been enjoying them for over a couple of years now, his floaters. They're tremendous. Great oysters, big, delicious. So I can't complain about how this aquaculture, where it's coming to, and what can be done with it. I think it's a great thing. There's no doubt about it. I'm supportive of oysters. I like oysters. The only time I didn't like oysters, I was told by a doctor I couldn't eat them for 6 months because of some treatment I was getting. No shellfish, and oysters were definitely condemned. I said, my God, I love oysters. But I couldn't eat them for 6 months. But that's okay. That's in the past. I can eat them fine now. But the thing of it is, we're going to Annapolis. We've got another meeting, I think, around the 10th, somewhere around the 10th or 16th of September next week, no, the following week, and to continue with this Tiger team. And I think we're trying to get a dialogue right now, and I think communications is starting to get a little better. So we'll see what happens during that particular meeting. And like I said, this would come up. We've got to leave it right now. The county will receive public comment on this matter for an additional 7 days. Comments should be mailed to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County at Post Office Box 653, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650, or email to csmc@stmarysmaryland.com. At this time, I think we've spoken enough. And this great, believe me, people have been watching this. We've got some tremendous people that have come here from the St. Mary's County group, both landowners and watermen, water people, whatever we'll call them. Might be some ladies out there probably catching oysters too. But anyway, I know from just my experience with Mr. Petty and his oyster farm, him and his wife have a tremendous operation going, and I was impressed 2 years ago when I went out there and saw it. And but of course, nobody complained about his lease because it's around his property, so he'd have to complain to himself. But I'm not against all this. We just need better communications between DNR and the people that's affecting. And I'm glad I'm learning this experience myself, and we'll work this out. This is a good start right here. This is a good start. So at this time, I will close the public hearing.